This is your captain speaking. We are making our descent into Las Vegas McCarran Airport. On behalf of our crew, we'd like to thank you for flying MMA Junkie Airlines. Now please fasten your seatbelts and put your tray tables in your upright position because the descent is gonna be a little bit bumpy.
Alright, Junkie Nation, it's time to roll, baby, on MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Ghost. This is what we do and why we do it, baby. All night long, we rollin'!
The MMA Junkie Radio revolution is upon us.
Can you dig it?
There's no escape. No escape. Through the vast frontier of cyberspace and through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and SiriusXM satellite radio technology. MMA Junkie Radio. Commence transmission. Live from MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Ghost.
From the fight capital of the world, inside the beautiful Mandalay Bay Racing Sportsbook, you're listening to the MMA Junkie Radio Show, the only show that matters. I'm your host, Gorgeous George. With me, as always, is the devious and dastardly Goes, our East co-host, back east, handling the producing duties, Danny Otto. And today is a PFL takeover. We're going to be talking about the Professional Fighters League, which has PFL 11 right around the Kona, the championship. And we have some special in-studio guests, along with Lewis Taylor, who will call in towards the end of the show. Want to welcome to the far right, Lance Palmer, who is one of the two participants in the featherweight division. He will be fighting Steven Seiler. Welcome, Lance. How you doing?
Yeah.
Doing good.
All right. And this is Ray Suffo, frequent co-host of the show, president of the PFL, and, of course, one of the striking coaches over at Extreme Couture. Welcome, Ray.
Thank you, sir.
How you doing?
Feeling great.
It's almost here. The almost championship,
here.
Man.
Almost here.
You get to sign off on $1 million checks.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Very impressed. You guys pulled it off. I mean, we got to get there, but we're less than 2 weeks away.
Right, right. I mean, you know, when you're talking to the team and they say, hey, how's the fighters? I'm like, when I don't hear from them, that's good news. Mm-hmm. It means everything is going to according to plan, right?
Yeah.
So, fingers crossed, knock on wood, that stays like that and all the guys are healthy and strong for the finals.
Yeah. Lance, maybe you can speak on that. What is the anticipation and the anxiety, if you have any, been these last few months? And just, you know, you don't want to stub your toe or catch a flu or whatever. I mean, just making sure that everything is smoothly so that you're tip-top on December 31st.
I think when it comes to stuff like that, it's more of the less you think about it, the less it's going to happen. When you're always worried about getting sick or getting hurt, that's usually when it happens. So I just focus on training and focus on getting ready for the fight, and all that other stuff is out of your control anyway.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel like you've gotten better just in these last 6 weeks, or basically what got you to the dance is going to be what we saw throughout the regular season and the playoffs?
I feel like I've gotten better each fight throughout this year.
Yeah.
Since moving my training camp to Vegas last March, each fight has been a progression of my evolution throughout this year. So I think you're going to see the best version of Lance Palmer on December 31st.
I ask because when I do go to Extreme and I watch pro practice, you guys have a sequence of what you guys do where they'll introduce a technique and then you guys will, you know, that do that, and then there'll be like a twist to it or whatever. And I see you all doing it with the coaches kind of coming around saying, do this, don't do that, blah, blah, blah. And I often wonder how many of those wrinkles do get added to a game just in between the fight camps.
Yeah, there's a lot of different moving parts to my training camp and my coaching staff, and so there's a lot of things that people don't get to see outside of practice, just working one-on-ones with the coach, whether it's striking or grappling or just the, you know, the mental game, watching tape and kind of going over some things since I did fight Seiler last year already. So going over a couple things that I can improve on to not only get the win again, but get the finish as well.
To piggyback a little bit off of George's question, What about Siler? Do you feel like he's gotten better since the last time you faced him?
I don't know. It's hard to tell. I mean, a lot of his fights, he's looked better. His striking has looked a little better. He's also at a new team. So we both changed teams from the time that we fought last year. But I think that I've progressed a lot more in the last year. And I've definitively won all my fights this year. And, you know, regardless, he's the one in the finals, so he's the one I have to fight. So I respect everybody that I fight. I've never looked past somebody, and he's a tough opponent, and he's gotten to this point, so he's the one across the cage.
That change over to Extreme Couture, there's a point where you show up, and you're a known name, but you're the new guy in the gym. How long did it take for you to feel like, all right, I've been accepted into this team? And then it kind of translates almost into family, right?
Yeah, I think it was about a week. It didn't take very long.
Yeah, I was going to say, it was like he went in there. Well, hey, what's up?
Yeah, I'm not somebody who kind of like is afraid to make friends and, you know, get to know everybody. So right away, it was like with Eric, with Dennis. Obviously, I've already known Ray for a long time. So just getting in there and kind of getting my feet wet. I'm not somebody who's just going to tiptoe around the gym. I got in there. I already knew a lot of the fighters already, so it was kind of, it was pretty seamless, honestly. It worked the best that I could have thought.
Can I share with you guys, when we were in New York, we were there last week, we had this, well, I don't know if George did, but I did. I had this shit got real kind of moment, and it was when I was in Times Square, and your face popped up on one of the big screens and in the commercial. Right. And not only was it fun to point to George and go, look, but what was fun was seeing people's reactions and them. There's so many things going on, but a lot of them did this. Or they just went like that, right? Right. What was your guys' shit got real moment for this season?
I think for me, just the start of it all, and then just to see it progress the way it did, I think that's where it got, everything became real. Because, you know, again, we were prepping up for it for a while. And so whenever the first show we had, I was like, wow, this is awesome. And especially the way the featherweights and the heavyweights kicked the season off. And then the middleweights and the welterweights, the very next show, did exactly the same thing. Just everybody just kind of followed suit. I mean, you know, it was amazing. And the fact that now, you know, we were doing some media stuff in New York before the last playoffs. And again, like you were saying, we were in the middle of I was going to say Town Square. and... You know, the PFL came up on the big screens and on the building and whatnot. And, you know, you can see all the commercials with Kevin Hart and all the boys fighting Lance, Vinny, you know, and everybody else that was on the card. And it just looked truly amazing. And so I'm really excited for the championship. And, you know, I'm excited just to kick off the next season as well. You know, can't wait for that as well.
Did you have an oh shit real moment? What would you call it?
Shit got real.
Shit got real moment?
I think it was before the very first fight, since the featherweights kicked it off in the same arena that we're going to finish it off New Year's Eve. It was like the very first day or second night that I was there, we were walking around Madison Square Garden, and one of the electronic billboards popped up with myself and Andre Harrison, and it just had, you know, PFL, and it had the date and basically the whole fight thing on the electronic billboard. And I was like, that's pretty cool having that right outside Madison Square Garden. Like, millions of people walk past that every day. Mm-hmm. And it was a cool moment. So Eric actually took a picture in front of it and I posted it, and it was like 3 days before the very first fight of the season.
Wow. You know, this is your profession, your job is very unique. And there are a lot of people on our sport that have kind of shit on our sport early on. Is there anybody in your life particularly that you could send that video or that text and go, what's up now? Because we've had them in our lives.
I mean, there's a lot of people that are probably like haters when you win, or they just want to see you lose. But honestly, the people that I keep very close to me are all people that are, you know, people that support me 100%. And there's nobody that doubted from the time I was in middle school, even just with wrestling, nobody doubted that I could be in this position where I'm at right now. So I don't think so. And
you
the people
talked to your high school, maybe a gym named after you or something.
Nah, I don't really want that kind
no?
of. I mean, I wouldn't mind donating back to something like that, but I wouldn't want my name on it.
No, yeah. Why not?
Because I got 4 state titles in my high school. I don't really need my name just like.
Yeah, look at that guy. That was a gangster
gym.
Answer, huh?
It's like people that know wrestling at St. Edward High School, they know Lance Palmer. I don't really need to like flaunt it by putting my name on a gym.
St. what?
St. Edward High School.
Are you the best wrestler to come out of St. Edward High School? Or is
I was is there another the. Guy well, I don't really know if. Like,
I just, well, I'm wondering if you guys are like a machine. Best. Like, there's, you know, like year after year, is a lot of superstars or.
Yeah, there's. I think I was the second 4-time state champ out of there. But record wise, I may have had the best record to come out of.
What was
there's
it?
Like. Ryan Lang was the first 4-timer.
No, but what was your record?
Oh, 150-6.
Wow. Yeah.
Singlet impressive. Retired?
No, I actually still have my senior year singlet. Yeah. I think it's at my parents' house.
We had our jerseys retired in the cafeteria.
Nice.
No, yeah, he's right. I was telling you earlier, from Madison Square Garden all the way to Times Square, and I got to see the billboards and all that. It was really, really surreal. Great location, you know,
right.
for the finale. But, man, I can't say enough about what you guys – Remember, this was 5 years ago, right?
Right.
The $1 million.
Right.
And it finally came to fruition. And now, or it will be, you know, in a few weeks. And you guys are going to change lives. And I think you guys are going to, like, a lot of people already know and have taken notice. A lot of people are hearing that the fighters are getting paid well along the way. That the runner-up gets $200,000.
Right.
You know, and like you said it, and you beat me to it. 2019, what the fuck's that gonna be like, you know?
Right.
I mean, I wish if he had like in his back pocket the list of the 72 fighters. Is it gonna be 6 divisions again, or is it gonna be more?
Yep, 6.
Like, I bet you, like, we'd stand back and go, wow, you know, because mm-hmm. it's just gonna get tougher and tougher and deeper and deeper.
Yeah, right. It's changing a lot of fighters' lives. And you know what the crazy thing about this is? And I was trying to explain this to Rodney yesterday. $200,000 is a great amount of money for your fight,
right?
And but that money technically is kind of a letdown, right?
Well,
and
compared
it's $200,000.
Just the other day, I was at Wheel of Fortune over here spinning, and I wanted the $1,200, and I got $400, and I was like, "Ah, you're right."
Yeah.
But I was happy I had $400.
But that's how crazy things
I
have
know,
been changed.
I know. But you, I remember we've talked to both of you. Neither one of you is really concerned with that figure. You want to win first, and you know it'll come with it. But is that just talk to shut us up, or do you find yourself dreaming about holding that check for $1 million?
I just want to be the best. When it comes down to it, it's not $1 million when you after you pay for everything. If it was $1 million out the door, like, you don't pay your coaches, you don't have to pay anybody else, you go sit like, you know, Duck McScrooge or whatever it is, like, you just had all your money in your bathtub, it'd be one thing. But people don't realize you pay taxes, you pay your coaches, you pay your manager. There's a lot that goes into it. So the money for me, yeah, it's a nice amount of money, but $1 million in 2018 isn't the same as $1 million in 2000.
Mm-hmm. Still a lot of money, though.
If you're a millionaire in 2000, you're a real millionaere. Nowadays, making $100,000 isn't that much. So when it comes down to it, I don't really – the money's always going to come and go. You can make $100 million, and that money's eventually going to go away. No matter what.
But isn't it nice to hear
one?
Just what Lance just said, like, $100,000 isn't really that much. See, it's easy for him to say because he can make that kind of earning.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of people out there, they wish they could win $100,000.
Yeah. Well, I know.
Does that make sense?
Oh, hell yeah.
I know firsthand because my parents, like, I talked to my dad yesterday, actually, because I was driving to Orange County, and I was on the phone with my dad, and I was like, he was talking about, like, we're having to work over the winter because he didn't make enough hours for unemployment,
right,
and all this other stuff. And I'm like, man, that's so crazy because it's like one fight for me, and
right,
I make more than a lot of people will make in 1 year,
right,
working a regular,
exactly,
job. But
exactly,
also the stuff behind the scenes that we have to pay for that goes into just one fight camp is also a lot more than people have to pay. And
right,
people get their taxes taken out before they even see their check and everything else. So there's a lot of pros and cons to it. So back to your original question, it's more about me winning the belt and being the inaugural featherweight champ of PFL. And yes, the money's going to be great. And the money is that's definitely a great prize on top of the belt.
What does the fight camp cost you?
Shoot. I would say since I have to travel here and this isn't my home base, I would say somewhere it's probably about 15,000 to 20,000.
Yeah, that's about right. Because when I would start, when I would do
this
camp,
is my fourth one of the year.
Right. So when I would do camp as well, that's exactly about right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that includes your partners, your training partners that you bring in, or
coaches, manager, partners, food, my rental car, my apartment.
Why do you drive to the OC once a week? What's so important there?
Twice
a week.
Oh. Yeah. I do my strength and conditioning there. I've been.
All of Vegas doesn't have one guy that can crack that whip?
Not like this. This is a mathematician, scientist who's worked 25
guy?
Years. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
What's the fastest you've ever made it to the OC? We were just talking about this morning.
I think I made it in about 2 hours and 50 minutes once.
He was bragging that he made it in three.
Well, I made it in 2 hours and 57 minutes.
Oh, nice.
Hold on a second.
So he beat you by 7 minutes.
From where to where?
From Summerlin South to
Yorba Linda.
What exit? It's right past the Yorba Linda Boulevard exit. Whatever the next exit is.
He gained a little bit more on this end and then took a little bit off on that end, right? But your guys are in the same ballpark.
No, he didn't do that. He didn't. He meant to say 3 hours and 40 minutes. Because I just
told
the
traffic.
Story.
That's what I did last night.
With
in
traffic? Come on, Lance. There's no way.
Yeah.
What's the rental car that you have?
I'll jump in the car the next time with you and just
the
and,
rental,
and say go.
The rental
no
car
way
I use is a Nissan Maxima, but that's what I've been driving there.
I was proud. I just spent about 5 minutes telling everybody in my 7 Series BMW that I had. I was going about 120 miles an hour at certain stretches just to do door
just
to door
up.
In 2 hours and 57 minutes. You come out of nowhere and blow my story out of the water. I have to come back and
so what you're saying is
it's
so
not about the 120 for 10 minutes and then 65, though. You got to keep
120.
The pace. You got to keep the pace at least 90.
And not get pulled over.
Yeah.
Well, back to.
But that was with Lance getting pulled over twice.
And I still beat it.
Yeah. Don't do that anymore. Just
nah,
stick
I didn't
to
get
70.
Pulled over. Yeah.
Stick to 70. You know, we got to get
well, the speed limit's
New
York. 70. You got to do at least 80 because you're safe. Nobody's going to pull you over doing 80.
True. All right. But what impressed you about this strength and conditioning guy that you were like, wow, okay, I have to do this drug?
Because it's more than just strength and conditioning. He has everything mapped out as far as food, your diet, your intake versus your output for each training session.
How many camps have you done this?
This is my first camp with him.
Oh, why change things up as you go into the biggest fight?
Everybody, including the UFC PI, has been trying to steal his information. And so he's been super selective on people that he lets in. And I've known this guy for almost 8 years because he worked with Mark Munoz. And I used to go to Rain. Me and TJ used to go to Rain together when I first started fighting in like 2011. And we would drive down there, train at King's MMA, go to Rain Training Center. And I actually met Sam back then because he would help with this wrestling camp Munoz used to run. And I'm really good friends with David Taylor, who's a world champion wrestler from Penn State. And he works with Sam as well from a distance. And Sam works with Penn State's team. And so it was like it was a big thing of where he didn't really want to bring me on because I went to Ohio State. And I guess Ohio State's coach has been trying to hire him and get his information of what he's doing to make Penn State the perennial champions that they've been the last 8 years. And so there was a lot that went into it, but if it would have been my choice, I would have started with him the beginning of this year and been with him through the entire year.
Damn.
But it just worked out that, you know, we had a long talk about everything, and, you know, he knows that I'm not affiliated with Ohio State Wrestling as far as, like, giving them information or whatever. Even if you had information, you still wouldn't be able to do what he does because this guy's He's got algorithms and 25 years of studying the human body and how it works. And it's honestly, he was explaining it to the ESPN people last night because they were there filming TJ for his fight coming up. And they were just looking at each other like, what the fuck is
this? What's he talking about? Yeah.
Yeah, it's like just talking about sleep cycles and all this other stuff, and they had no idea what he was talking about. So it, even if you were, like, privy to all that information, you would have no clue how to, like, run somebody's camp.
Explain it to somebody.
Yeah, because they're bringing TJ to 125, and he's ahead of schedule, and he's still right where he needs to be strength-wise. His cardio is great. He's still eating every meal. Like, he's not starving to death like most people. And that was the main thing for me, is my weight cuts are always hard when it comes down to the last day. And so we'll see on December 31st.
You're old school. Are you buying into all the new science that has taken over our sport?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they, you know, if I was to go back, there was a guy that you know, but again, I, when it came to nutrition and all that stuff back then, I was illiterate because I was never told anything about anything. And so all the little information that I got, I had to read about it or just talk to certain friends that was in the industry. And 100%, yeah, you know, all this new studies and for example, the gentleman that Naz is working with, I mean, if he spent 25 years studying the human body and understanding it, you need to soak all that up, and you know, and because I'm assuming that it can only help, you know, your progression, your strength, your energy levels. Again, yeah, old school. Would I train the way I train? Yeah, absolutely. Would I add all that information into it back then? 100%. 100%.
Mm. All right, interesting. Two times a week you drive 2 hours and 40 minutes back and forth to Orange way. County. Yeah. And what's that do to your body, by the way? Isn't it like...
Now, I wouldn't do that drive.
I was going to say that.
But...
McCarran to Ontario? You haven't thought of that one?
He's still...
Well, the problem is bringing all my meals, because TSA is so weird about bringing food and different types of liquids and
I
stuff.
I thought you were driving in, doing a session, and driving back. So you're staying there like a full 24 hours?
No.
Oh.
Driving in, do my session, pick up my food, go home.
Damn.
So my meals from Wednesday night until Saturday I bring with me. So to bring that on a plane, I don't know how that would work. I've had trouble with a tiny bit of peanut butter trying to bring it through TSA. So I'd have to check the bag, and then they throw your bag like it's a fucking... it's like they have a hammer out there, and they're just trying to smash your bag.
Mm-hmm. What kind of food do you eat? Is that your bookie?
I don't know who that is, actually. 833 number. I don't know what that is. Did you guys start getting telemarketers?
Yes.
What the heck?
Stop, dude.
It's so annoying.
Yeah.
I hate that. It's all just clean food, no grains. Certain things that we do, all the testing at the beginning of camp to see like what your body reacts to, what it rejects, what causes inflammation. So it's not just strength and conditioning. This is a whole system that has helped me just nutrition-wise and energy-wise to be more metabolically efficient, and that's basically the easiest way to put it without confusing anybody.
I'm thinking about interviews we did 10 years ago, and they sounded nothing like this.
Yeah.
This is amazing, man.
Fighters have changed a lot.
Yeah, technology.
Like, I don't even know if you stopped fighting today, would you even be able to go back to, like, your former self? I mean, I think you just keep doing the same stuff, right?
Because
I've always been this
endless
way.
Endless Chipotle coupons,
yeah,
and
Taco
all that.
Bell.
And now we're talking about the electrolytes.
Oh, don't get me wrong. I still, like, after I win on the 31st, I'm still gonna binge on some nasty food because it tastes good. I'm gonna feel like crap.
It's not nasty food. It's good food.
Yeah,
real good food.
Yeah. It's soul food.
Yeah, exactly.
Good for the soul.
Exactly.
Bad for the gut. Good for the soul.
You fought in New Orleans, right?
Yep.
Did you have any Cajun food post-fight?
No, it sucked because I had to leave the next morning after the fight.
Oh, yeah.
And I wasn't going to eat that the night before the fight. So
you'd shit on your opponent.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah.
Wow. And then
maybe
back to Harrison. Tell me what that win meant to you. You gave him his first loss. a lot of people had you guys pegged as the finalists, and yet we had you two colliding in the, we'll call it the semifinals. But what did that mean? Sorry, what did that win mean to you?
It meant a lot just because of the circumstance of what happened in the first fight and breaking my hand in the first, like, 2 minutes of the first round. That changed. When you have an injury like that and your adrenaline dumps, there's a weird energy expenditure, I guess, or an inability to expend energy. It's a weird feeling. Your body feels like a million pounds. And after I broke my hand, I felt like I had no energy. I had no left hand to be able to grip or grapple. So that was kind of out of the question. And to be able to fight through that fight and through that adversity and still win, I think I still won two rounds on some of the judges' cards. And that was always in my mind, even this entire season. It wasn't in my mind just to want to fight Harrison, but to get that win back eventually, because I knew I would end up fighting him. Mm-hmm. But to go through what I considered the tougher side of the bracket and come out of that was very important, and to get the win was important. But obviously, I feel like I'm going to see him again next year at some point. So,
what feedback would you give the management guys as far as how the season played out? Like the points. Did you like the points? Did you like the separation of time in between fights? I imagine that's what that type of workplace does, the same way other workplaces say, hey, what would you like done better? And what would you be your feedback for season one, or so that they can apply to season two?
I think the idea of moving the fights earlier in the year so they're a little more spread out is good. But also, the way that the first two fights played out was great, because I went home for 2 weeks after the fight in June, came back, was still in shape for the last 4 weeks of camp before my next fight, because they were 6 weeks apart. So that was fine. And then the 11 weeks from that fight to the playoffs was good, because it gave me about 3 or 4 weeks at home to be able to see my family, relax, let my body heal up if there was anything to heal, then have 8 full weeks. Honestly, like, fighting this much, 8 weeks is a long time for camp. I feel like this, the last camp for quarters and semis and this camp for the finals have felt super long, because those first two fights were I was only in Vegas for like 5 weeks for my first camp. I was finishing a EMT course back home for firefighting and stuff like that, just to have on the side. And I actually took my final out here at a testing center in like end of April, and then I was here for the last 5 weeks, I think. And so,
you want to be a firefighter?
I think after I'm done fighting, it might be something that I want to do. So firefighter, paramedic, pension and everything is top notch, and I have a lot of friends who are in that. I mean, Stipe does it and he still fights, but yeah. I don't have a camp back home that I could just train at and work at, so it's something for after.
Can you name 4 other MMA related firefighters?
MMA? No.
Really?
I don't know any other people.
Chris Lytle,
besides.
Remember him?
Oh, nice.
He's a firefighter.
Okay.
Eddie Wineland, remember him?
Yeah.
He's a firefighter. Eric Del Fiero, he's a coach at Alliance.
Yep.
He's a firefighter. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember my next one. Who's my next one?
Don Fry.
Well, Don Fry, yeah, he actually left.
Or Stipe.
You know, yeah, Stipe was already said, but Don Fry left to take one of his fights. He actually quit, you know.
Oh, wow.
No, the other one was a guy named Chad Griggs.
Oh, yeah.
He lives in Arizona, but okay. He was also a firefighter.
Nice.
Yeah. Firefighters, I think, just got a little bit of scoreboard over police officers when it comes to our sport.
Yeah. It's still.
We've got a few police officers. But
yeah. It's a dangerous job, but it's less. Being a police officer nowadays is a whole different ballgame compared to what it used to be. And
Ulysses Gomez is a police officer. Did you hear that?
Really?
Who? John Alessio,
too. Oh. Ulysses Gomez and
John Alessio is a cop as well.
Police officers now.
Yeah. And I've never really wanted to be a cop. I think that it takes a certain person to
look. I'd always wanted to be a cop.
Yeah?
Yeah. I did.
Okay.
I'd rather do, like, SWAT. Like, I train a kid back home.
That'd be interesting.
And his dad's a SWAT officer, so I train him at the SWAT office before I had mats in my basement. And he's a great dude.
What about
dude.
Border Patrol? Would you want to be Border Patrol?
No, I actually got offered a job for that.
Did you?
Yeah, yeah, it's a government job.
And? Did you think about it? Or was it
hell
quick? No.
What
didn't you like about it?
Just being away from home. I'm away from home enough now, and I don't even have kids yet. That right. just sound terrible.
Yeah. Yeah. Randomly, they chose your name, or how did this come about?
Was so this, you actually this guy that trained my American bully in Columbus, Ohio, they were actually on Shark Tank. This might be a little plug for him anyway, but they were on Shark Tank as protection dog company, and they do government dogs, protection dogs. They just sold like three Malamutes to the Dubai government or something. They're like 70,000 each. Yeah.
The one that looks like the German Shepherd?
Yeah, okay. But they're smaller, more athletic, meaner. And they train those dogs. And he used to work on Border Patrol before that. And it's called Priority Canine. And they do so I basically had them do a course with my dog for a few weeks while I was out of town.
You have a Belgian too?
No, I have an American Bully.
Oh, you said that.
Yeah, but he has really high drive, and he's a dog that just needs, like, extra reinforcement. And so they worked with him for a few weeks, but he was telling me about that. It was actually last New Year's Eve. It was the first time I met this guy, and he and his wife do it together. They train these dogs, and she's like, when she steps in the room, the dogs just sit and stare at her. It's crazy how they just, like, know.
Right.
Like, certain personalities, they just know, like, she's the boss.
Right. Wow.
And she actually, like, trains them better than he does.
Yeah.
But it's pretty crazy. Like, these dogs go for 70 and 90 grand a dog. Damn. And they go through five or six dogs till they get the one that is right. Like, if they're training a dog, they know
like that,
it's
but
not
for
the
blind,
dog.
Those service dogs for the blind.
Oh, yeah.
What was the name of that movie on the plane?
On the airplane. Yeah, I don't remember.
You guys will be traveling soon, and I don't know what airline you're taking, but there was one, and it had to do with dogs that are bred. It's a lab, Labrador, and they also get weeded out. They go through a process, and they go through different levels of trainers until you get to the one, like you said, where the lady, like, you know, this is how it's done.
Oh, yeah.
But they have to service the blind. So obviously they have to be the creme de la creme when it comes to the dogs. You need to stop within a certain amount of time as you see a car coming.
Yep.
It's like that anticipation, the buffer. And so they have to go through those types of testing. But it was very, very interesting.
It is. It's pretty crazy. It's wild to think that they like filter through these dogs and they're like, oh, this one's not going to be a, you know, a protection dog, or this one's not going to be a canine.
Like, same breed though, right?
Yeah, a lot of them are same breed. Like now they're moving into those Belgium dogs instead of the German Shepherds, just because of their athleticism, and they're a little smaller, but they're still have that high drive, and they're super mean. Oh, can be super mean, but they're good for like canine dogs and stuff. Yeah. It's crazy. Wow.
I could see him being an air marshal.
Yeah.
Want to be an air marshal?
I think it'd be cool if I was able to do it, like, wherever I was going. Like, on the way to my fight, and just, like, get paid
like
on the clock. Yeah, exactly.
Hey, I'm here now. Can I get in?
Yeah.
Did you know Ray was a model?
Yeah. I heard he was a foot model.
He walked he walked runways.
Yeah. Heck yeah. That's awesome.
How many years ago was that, Ray?
Where are we now? 2018? It would have been about 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Dang.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Huh. Do you miss not, like, taking that and doing other forms of entertainment, or are you glad you went to combat?
You talking
sports,
like Chippendales?
What was it, like magazines? television?
Yeah, just everything with to do with magazines, TV, TV commercials.
That's awesome.
Fashion shows. There's a show called the Corbin. Well, back then it was called the Corbins, which there's a lot of international models that gets brought over from around the world. And there are certain guys that get selected for it. So I think there's, as male models, I think there's only 8 guys selected for that particular show and 30 women, I think. Mm-hmm. So, wow. Yeah. So that kind of thing. You know, there was a lot of, listen, when I did it, it was a lot of fun and I fully enjoyed it because, you know, when you do something that you never think you would do, and that was one of those things. When as a kid, I never thought or even dreamt about being on the runway and being a model, let alone being on TV and doing a TV commercial, like, you know, chocolate bar or whatever it is, or
that's
Peter
awesome.
Britt ad or that kind of stuff. So, I loved every second of it.
You want some Race FO trivia?
Yeah, you like Lionel Richie? I know that.
Did you know that he was almost on the New Zealand version of ER, but
I
instead
did not know that.
He fought.
Yeah, that's right.
That's awesome.
But you know, that's a crazy story as well, because I went and cast for that. And when they call you back the second time, it means that 100% you got the job. Obviously, it doesn't mean that because after I got called back, they said, well, you know, you're going to be called next week to get wardrobe and all that, right? I get a call from my agent the following week saying, hey, Ray, we got some bad news. And that they've decided, you know, last minute to go with somebody else. And the reason why they went somebody else, because apparently the guy was actually managed by the casting agent. So, but it was also a blessing in disguise because right after that, 3 days later, I get a call from K1. And that was that. So although that door closed, something else had opened. Yeah. And here I am. You know what I mean? So I'm glad it all worked out that way.
That's awesome.
Yeah. All right.
I know we have to get going, so let's just finish up here with the fight. Steven Seiler, you already said you're looking for the finish.
Yep.
You come from a wrestling background, but do you see the finish more ground-oriented? Like, is that what the wrestler wakes up thinking or goes to bed thinking, or do you want to use them hands?
I think it could be either one because in the first fight I dropped him and almost had the finish in the first fight. But he's tough. You know, he's got a tough chin. And he can take a punch. We've already seen that in all of his fights this year. I had almost a submission attempt on him in the third round when we fought. So I see it happening either direction. It's just tightening all those things up and being sharp out there. But putting my whole game together for sure. And I know the finish will accumulate.
How big will the Palmer contingent be?
It's going to be pretty big. I actually just got another email for how many tickets I need today, and I think we have we have at least 25 strong plus other people who bought tickets. So
listen, you can have 500, but nobody will out-scream his father.
Exactly. He's going to be front and center. Ray's going to be yelling at him in between rounds.
Keep the language.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Well, we have to take a break, and I guess it's a good time to say goodbye, Lance. Hope whatever's left of camp is safe for you and productive. And
thank you.
Safe travels to New York, and good luck on the 31st.
Thank you. I'm excited.
All right, that's Lance Palmer, folks. Ray's going to stick around. We're also going to bring Vinny on. Lance can be followed on Twitter, at Lance Palmer. And remember, this all goes down on December 31st. It's PFL 11, the championship, 6 title fights, and Kayla Harrison, a guest of ours 2 days ago, will be featured on the main card as well. It's going to be a long main card, man, right?
It's going to be great. So many. Yeah. Yeah.
Five rounds. All right. All right, we'll be right back. It's MMA Junkie Radio on Fight Nation Channel 93.
Tell your boss to reschedule that meeting. Call your wife and tell her lunch is off. It's time for more MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Goes.
I just deleted the read.
Make one up.
Not that talented, Goes. I literally just had it. All right. My favorite channels outside of Fight Nation 93 are 88, which is the NFL radio, 86, which is NBA radio, and 33, which is First Wave. So check those out. And I promise you I'll find the reads in just a bit. Or if Danny can resend them. I don't know. I just hit like a delete button or something. Right as I was.
Apple
I wanted
email
to
is the worst.
I wanted to expand it. But all right, I want to welcome to the show Vinny Magalhaes, who will be fighting at PFL 11, the championship. He'll be facing Sean O'Connell. And these are the two finalists for the light heavyweight division. Welcome, Vinny. How you doing?
Pretty good, George. And you actually changed my last name again.
Magalhaes?
Yeah, every day you say differently.
what did it used to be?
Magalhaes. Wait. There is a Magalhaes. I know the Brazilians like to say shh.
It's more like people from Rio. You use the SH, the end of like every word that ends with an S. But you can say Magalhaes.
Magalhaes?
That works.
That's better? Oh. But there's no N in there. Magalhaes.
There's a tilde
on
top of the last A, which you know most people don't.
Like São Paulo. São Paulo.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay. You know, same thing I started off with, Lance. How has your camp been? How's your anticipation been? Sorry I'm so consumed with money, guys. I've been coming to Vegas for years, and I just – $1 million, you know, in poker, $1 million. The $1 million mark was huge, you know, if somebody was going to be a millionaire. Now, of course, people make – hundreds of millions, you know, and do all kinds of stuff. But that's just a number that's special to me. And I guess it's part envious and happy for you guys.
It's special to everybody. Yeah. I mean, like, when you think about it, like, you know, again, we were saying earlier, and Lance was right. But at the same time, if you think about the average Joe Bloke, that $1 million is a lot of money.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Mm. Of course, it all, you know, you live within your means, if you will. And fighters do live very well because they make good money. That being said, it's hard to kind of like understand the guy here. Like when we started, I mean, we didn't have anything. You know what I mean? So it's a completely different, you know, when you're in it, you go, yeah, why? You know, it's really not that lot of. But when you look back into where you started, it is a lot of money.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It is a lot of money, even after, like, you know, what Lance was saying, with taxes, management, and training fees and all that. Think about it. Let's say if you can clear $400,000 after all that, you know, all the expenses and all that. If you're a smart guy and you can actually budget your life, like, within, like,
right,
for the next 4 years, you can live, like, with $100,000 a year after paying everything. That's especially in Vegas, you know, low cost of living. Like, you can make a good living.
Yeah.
So if you're smart with that money, you know, if you make investments too, so that money can actually, like, now produce more money. So it's not a small amount of money, you know. Plus, there's always the next season, so
sure.
The next fight.
Look at these guys. So
see, Vinny's already thinking five seasons ahead.
$2 million. Huh?
We've talked to about 10 fighters that already started about talking about 2019. They love being with PFL. They want to stay with PFL if PFL will have them back. And this was around the time of the playoffs because we were talking, and I think we discussed this with you, Ray. During the playoffs, it was, even though the fighter had an opportunity to progress, anybody that lost, I guess, was also still auditioning for 2019.
Right. Because
you can go out on a losing note.
Right.
But if you fought your ass off, they'll have you back. You know what I mean? And so a lot of them wanted to put on a good show regardless, win or lose, because of that. Because that's how much PFL meant to them.
Right.
And this is – think about it. The last 2017 and 18, Bellator signed free agents.
Yeah.
Late 2018, won championship in the mix. Ryzen, of course, joined the party like 3 years ago, so they've been taking some guy. So free agency's been a big thing. So for fighters to already be saying, no, I like where I'm at, I'm staying with PFL, if they have me back, it's a testament to you guys.
Yeah, no, you know, again, it's, I mean, the format, I think, I know it works. And I've been saying this from day one when we first announced it. And now that we're into the first season, heading towards the championship final round, we've proven it works. You know what I mean? And so All the fighters love it because they're constantly in camp. Like I said, I've never seen Vinny so fit and so ripped, because the whole training camp, like, he's in training camp all year. You know what I mean? And like even Lance was saying, like, this 8-week, 10-week camp, it's long, when especially when you have 3-4 months off and then you got to start that next 10-week camp, where these guys are constantly, from after one fight, you know, they have a couple of weeks off and they're back into it, and 4 or 5 weeks later, they're back in the cage. You know what I mean? And so it really does work. And so, listen, this wouldn't be possible without the fighters. And so, you know, a big thank you to all the guys that competed throughout the season, because we can put everything together, but until the fighters can show up and really do what they do best, you don't have a show. And so a huge thank you to all the fighters, the PFL fighters.
You got Sean O'Connell. Man, that guy won't go away. That's a tough dude. You know, you got to break arms or knock him out, because he's going to just keep coming.
Which has happened 8 times in his career, you know. So
right.
Why not, like, again?
Right.
He's been finished 8 times, so it's one of those things. People say that a lot. He's, like, he's durable. Like, you know, he's one of those guys that he's tough. He takes shots and he keeps fighting. But then again, he's been finished 8 times already, so it's not something that's impossible to make happen. Right. And, you know, if you look at the tracking record, the amount of the time that's been finished and the amount of times that I've been finished, like, my opponents, like, you know, I feel like that's given some certain advantage, not just based on my fighting style, but just, like, you know, the record overall, you know, like, I feel like it's my favor.
Yeah. Oh, no, dude, you've been phenomenal. You've been one of the two MVPs. If we're going to treat it like a regular season in playoffs, like other sports, there's two MVPs, you and Ray Cooper. We'd have to have a panel of, like, 7, and
right.
3 would vote one way and 4 would vote the other, but that's what we discussed on this show, because you guys are very, very impressive.
And there's going to be a bonus for that too, actually. It was Ray was telling me he's going to give like $200,000 for the, you know.
Wow.
Amazing. Right, I'm breaking the news right now.
We got to take our last break. Let's do that right now. It's Fight Nation's MMA Junkie Radio, and we're going to be right back. This is the PFL Takeover. We have the president, Ray Cepho, here in studio with us. We were joined by Lance Palmer earlier, and now we have Vinny Magalhães. These are two of the 12 finalists that are going to be fighting on December 31st, PFL Championship. Excuse me, PFL 11, the championship. It's on NBC Sports, and it's a four-hour block that they've reserved because there's so many title fights. And Kayla Harrison will be featured. She was on earlier. Lewis Taylor's going to be on later in the show. So it's PFL everywhere here on the MMA Junkie Radio Show.
question.
If it's
a finish, I
will leave. They're so fat, they gave Dracula diabetes. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Goes.
Why does he keep doing that? Oh, boy. All right. Don't have my reads again. Oh, here they are. Here they are. Thanks, Danny. He sent them. See, I'm going here, Goes, because I don't want to put on my glasses right now. They're giving me a headache. And I'm just trying to expand it. And I keep deleting it like an idiot. It's Fantasy Football Championship Week, and Fantasy Sports Radio is helping you win. Listen to the best fantasy football experts for news, strategy, and advice to set a winning lineup. And if you've already been eliminated, listen for more ways to invest in the games you love on Fantasy Sports Radio, Sirius 210, XM87, streaming on your phone and at home on connected devices and speakers. Danny, turn up that song. You like this song, right?
Old school.
Awesome, isn't it?
Love it.
It'll never get old, right?
Nah, never.
Yeah. I knew he would appreciate it.
It's dope.
Duran's coming to Vegas.
Yeah, but they have insane prices.
I know. I couldn't believe it was like $300 to get in the door.
Are they doing the Chelsea again? Or?
At the Cosmopolitan. I was like, fuck, you're breaking my heart. How the hell am I supposed to get in there? Mm-hmm. $300 for me, $300 for Juliet. That's $600 plus $1,000 a night.
There's $1,000 a night.
You know what we should do?
But you know what?
Make friends with a millionaire. You know anybody?
Yeah. Talk to these guys.
Convince Vinny to have his after party there.
Jordan's laying the foundation.
How about you celebrate that big
party? You know, like, you know,
after
Texas training, it's not a lot of
money. We're down to $300,000. You know, the wife gets half. That's $150,000.
That's a fact.
You know, Frank Trigg used to always say that when he was co-hosting with us. You got to pay your accountant and your bookkeeper and your manager. You're like, shut up, Trigg. It ain't that bad. You guys make pretty good money, that's for sure. All right. How many people are going in the Magalhães contingent to New York?
As for now, like, I have like a few friends. Like one of my affiliated schools, like, is sending like some guys there. I have like three friends who are going from out of state, and from here, just my wife for now. And no, she wants to take the kids. I'm not sure about taking the kids for this fight, but they might go.
Yeah.
Just like the last one, the last one they were there.
Right. New York's awesome, man. It's a great city. It's a great night, New Year's Eve, you know? So I think you're right. Maybe the kids stay home on this one. You guys can go out and celebrate. I mean, I'm sure that's what you're picturing in your mind, you know?
No, definitely. Plus, you know, after this fight, I'm going to have like a couple weeks to rest and, like, I can, you know, enjoy some time with them.
Take them to Disney.
Right now, I haven't taken any time off. Like, Ray was talking about like 2 weeks off after fights. It's like, what are you talking about? 2 weeks off?
True.
I was taking mostly like 2 days off. Like,
this is just a quick break. It's the top of the hour break. We'll be right back in 60 seconds.
Even learning English from that, you know? It's like, I don't have that accent.
This is Dead or Alive, right?
You know it.
Their lead singer, I think his name is Peter Burns.
Uh-huh.
He passed away.
When?
I don't know, but a lot of these 80s bands made these comeback tours. Mm-hmm. And I looked at one, I said, I wonder if Dead or Alive would come back. I'm like, well, no, because unfortunately somebody, the lead singer, lived up to half the name.
You know that when they do like flashback shows now 90s is that.
Oh, wow.
When I was growing up, it was 80s was that.
Mm-hmm. Vinny was telling us. Can I say it, Vinny? Yeah, right? Tupac?
Tupac's
is it, you know, his favorite musical artist. Mm-hmm. Ray said Elvis, Lionel Richie, Duran Duran. Give me two more that you like, Vinny.
I don't know, man. Like, Tupac was, like, definitely my favorite. I don't really have, like, another one that's, like, oh, man, like, I have to listen to, like, these, his songs or anything like that. No, not really. Tupac ends up being, like, the only one.
Yeah.
Do you like the movie?
I haven't watched it.
No?
No.
It's not that good. I mean, it's all right. Tupac? There's times where he really looks like him, and then there's times where he doesn't.
No, I haven't watched that movie yet. Mm. You know, I like his music, but I'm not, you know, that big of a fan that I have to watch every single, like, I don't have to buy t-shirts and, yeah, posters and things like that.
Hmm. All right. Where do you plan on resting after win or lose? It's going to be a great night for you because it's been a great season. But what do you plan on doing to, like you said, you've had four camps and you want to spend some time with the kids. What do you think you're going to do when you come back from,
you know, New it's going to be a staycation. I'm not going anywhere. I'm just going to stay home and try to, like, you know, relax with the family. And, I mean, if they want to go somewhere, I'm going to have to take the whole family. Then you're going to go somewhere, like, you know, have a little vacation. But I'm not making big plans. It's like, again, like I said, I might take, like, 2 weeks off. Then after, I'm going to get back to training. Like, next year is a big year for me, too. There's PFL again. And also, there's the ATC next year. You know, I've been, like, in such a good shape. Like, you know, my mindset's, like, so good for competition right now that I'm planning on doing both. And, like, and since, like, I'm feeling so well physically, I'm planning on doing ATC and do just like I'm doing this year with PFL. Go there and win everything. So,
in Long Beach, right?
So, can I take time off? Yeah, it's going to be Long Beach. Mm. So, for me, like, you know, 2 weeks off is going to be, like, the most I'm going to take off. Like, you know, just to heal up, like, you know, the body a little bit, because it's been tough to train, like, 10 months, like, nonstop. You know, every now and then I feel like, you know, pain like here and there. But, you know, 2 weeks off should be enough.
But this dude has been in the gym, like, right after the fight. We get home. Monday you think he'll have off. He's in the gym on Monday.
Yeah.
And he fought on Thursday or Friday or Saturday, you know, depending on what was happening, regular season or playoffs. But he's in the gym on Sunday. So, it's like I've said, the season is actually – I've seen the best of Vinny through the season. Not only as what he's done in the cage, but also seeing him back in training camp. Like, 2 days later, right after he fought, he's in the gym already. So it's obviously working for him.
You know what I like about what you set up, Ray, is they're all million-dollar fights, but they all have their own little storylines underneath them.
Right, and absolutely.
And his is one that I'm going to watch completely different from all the other, because
I agree.
When we are sitting here in the mornings and we're doing our show, there's a big screen here up at Mandalay Bay, and you're seeing right now they have pro football, but they're constantly breaking down who the best were, right? And they'll put up, like, the quarterbacks, and it really comes down to the smallest of things.
Right.
And you have the opportunity, and I don't know if this is something that just we focus on or if it's something that you really keep in the back of your head, but the way you got through the tournament, first round, all stoppages, I'm going to be watching your fight two ways. Who's going to win the fight, and can Vinny keep that up? And possibly 10 years from now when we're breaking all this down.
Right, right.
That's a record that I feel like would almost be untouchable.
I agree.
Do you think about that at all, or is it just all about getting the win?
You know, it became like that became like my own personal, like, you know, goal too. Since I've done so well so far in this season, like, you know, I definitely, like, you know, have that in mind. If I can go there and finish this fight, like, in the first round, like, within under 2 minutes, just like I did the first fights, you know, that would be great. You always go there, you know, just like I did for the last fights. I was always expecting to have the toughest fight. They were not that tough, like, at the end of it. Like, I was able to finish those fights in under 2 minutes. So, that's the same mindset for this one. Nothing has changed, you know. It has changed the opponent. I'm fighting Sean now, but the mindset is still the same. Like, go there, try to do my best, and, like, you know, if it me doing my best ends up getting a win another, like, 2 minutes or something, that's great. You know, I was talking to Yves Edwards the other day. I was like, dude, they realize that I have now actually, like, 3 minutes and 30 seconds on this fight, which is much more than I've done, like, the last few fights. If I finish it with 3 minutes and 30 seconds, I still get, like, 2 minutes average per fight. So it's like, that's not bad at all. Yeah. So that means that I still have, like, almost double the time to actually, like, you know, finish this fight.
Yeah, the other reason that I find your fight unique is when you came into the sport, we were talking to Lance, and all the stuff he was talking about made me think of, like, Rocky IV when you saw Ivan Drago and the computers and all that. Right. And then I started thinking of you, and I kept looking at you off camera because you've kind of done a little bit of both eras, right? Where when I first came here, I would go to these gyms, and you would see some of the best fighters get together, And they would go. They would call each other in the morning, like, "Where do you want to go today?" And you would go, and they would have these training sessions, and they would say things like, "We gotta hurry up because Pilates starts at 6, and we all gotta get out." But now there's these big gyms, you know, and it started with Extreme Couture and Tap Out and Syndicate. They all got bigger and bigger. And I don't know that he experienced some of the stuff that you probably experienced when you first came in, and that's kind of like the smaller gyms, fighters just actually getting in a circle and talking about what works for you, what, and trying to figure all that out. You're fighting for the same thing, but in my head, you guys are fighting for two different things because you came from two different eras, and you had a taste of both of them. Do you ever think of things like that?
I do. You know, it's funny. Like, that's what I tell people, too. I think I've brought that up before, how I got into Ultimate Fighter just, like, doing jiu-jitsu, nothing else. And I was literally still with that mindset, the Royce Gracie mindset, all you need is jiu-jitsu, you know? If you can take somebody down, you're in the world, like, you're not going to finish anybody. And that was not the reality, you know? It was, like, literally, like, when I start fighting MMA, I was in the middle of that transition where people were already, like, cross-training, you know? They're already, like, doing, like, both, like, boxing and jiu-jitsu. They're doing, like, wrestling jiu-jitsu, like, doing three different martial arts in order to become fighters. But my mindset was still the old-school mindset, like, well, all I need is jiu-jitsu. That's the most complete martial arts ever. So, you know, as long as people take me down, if I fight a wrestler, they're going to take me down, I'll finish them. If I can take them down, if I fight a striker, I can take them down, I'm going to finish them. And that was just, like, the wrong mindset. And obviously, like, you know, through the years, you know, I kept fighting and I kept, like, and I just, like, my training style. I, you know, got into, like, a real training camp. Like, I got with, like, real training partners, real trainers. And I finally, like, you know, adjusted myself, like, to the modern, like, style of MMA. So I feel like, you know, even though, like, I'm at 34 now, I still have, like, time to, like, you know, be one of those guys that's, like, that's a complete fighter. I might never reach, like, a high level as a striker, but I feel like, you know, I have the time to reach that level where people are going to respect my striking. Mm-hmm. Just like they're going to have to respect my wrestling. That's just, like, how they already respect my ground game. So it's, like, I have the time.
Even when you think about teaching, like, you've taught before at these schools. Like, I remember walking into a tap-out gym one time, and I remember looking to the right, and Kevin Randleman's teaching kids how to wrestle. And you're teaching kids jiu-jitsu. And I started thinking, like, you know how fucking crazy that would be for us? Like, it would be like walking into a gym and Peyton Manning showing people how to throw a football, little kids, right? And then you got, like, Eric Dickerson showing people how to run a football. Like, you don't have access to people of that high level. Mm-hmm. And to be able to humble yourself and actually teach people, because a lot of people, especially in combat sports, sometimes they like to keep those secrets to themselves. And you guys were so easy with giving pointers to whoever. It didn't matter if it was somebody on your level or somebody even down here. Your road to this is insane, man.
I know, man. It's like, you know, it's 20 years of martial arts and, like, you know, 12 years of professional fighting. So it's like, I do have a lot of stories to tell. You know, it's funny. I was making my breakfast today. I was thinking, you know, like, I win this whole thing, especially I have, like, so many ups and downs in my career. I win this whole thing and I do so well, especially having a great year, which started, like, not even, like, in MMA, but I had a great year starting beating Gordon Ryan, who is now, like, people
right.
claim to be, like, the best grappler in the world. Like, and literally I was training for a month when I beat that guy. So besides, like, you know,
that's the, I don't know if you remember, that's Quintet. The guy from Quintet, yeah.
Yeah, so besides, like, beating that guy, who's, like, you know, people claim to be the best grappler in the world, like, that's how I started my year. There's also, like, these four finishes with PFL, possibly, like, going to five now. So it's like, man, like, you know, I do have some stories to tell besides, like, you know, this year, but, like, you know, through my whole career, these ups and downs, like, world titles, like, you know, fighting for titles that I've won and some fighting for titles that I've lost. And all that, I was like, dude, I might as well just, like, write a book. I'm going to have the money now, so might as well just, like, spend some money.
Ray, I want to ask you the same thing I asked Vinny. What are you going to do when you come back from New York? How much time will you have before you have to start diving into 2019?
I'm diving in 2019 right away. Matter of fact, I have had to send out emails to certain people, managers and fighters and whatnot. You know, there's this, because I'm getting loads and loads of emails from managers and fighters that from all over the world that wants to be in PFL for 2019. A lot of those emails are great emails because there's some serious names on there. And then there are some names on there that I'm like, guys, this is not that level, you know. So, you know, that's already starting. And basically when I get back from New York after the, you know, after the championships, it's right back to work because May's going to come around like this, you know. And so it's work.
What divisions will be, can you tell us yet, in 2019?
Pretty much very similar to what we have for 2018. Yeah.
Because Kayla Harrison told us that I think there's going to be one for her, right?
Correct. Yep.
So you might have more than six divisions.
Yeah, very possible. We haven't finalized that yet. It's just depending on we got to talk to the network and just to finalize how that all would work together. And it's either one gets added or one gets deducted, if you will.
Yeah.
So.
And the process will still be having like 18 fighters fight for the final, or 12 fighters fight for the final. Like,
correct.
I was thinking March or April if you would have any sort of qualifiers to become one of them or anything like that, just because some of the divisions are so stacked.
You know, there is a few things in the works as well in terms of that kind of thing. You can't really go into it, you know, until we actually finalize and put it all together, because that's still in the early stages of development. There is a possibility that something like that could happen. So, you know.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, this is crazy stuff. I was just looking at the names that started off, and I thought Harrison was going to be one of the finalists, and he wasn't. I thought Brooks was going to be one of the finalists at 55, and he wasn't. I mean, mm-hmm. this whole season, like, I got a few of them right, but I got quite a few of them wrong. I thought either Shields or Story could make that finals.
But there's a lot. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of surprises in the season. And again, you know, there's a lot at stake, and so a lot of these guys. Perfect example is a guy that's sitting next to my right. It's like
I knew he was going to go to the finals.
But the thing is, I didn't know, because you never know when that bell rings, and Vinny has been absolutely. And when you talk about, you know, VP. He's one of those guys, you know what I mean? Like, MVP for season number one, 100%. It's like, I see this guy at training every day. And so to see him come out and do what he's done for the season is absolutely amazing. And, you know, and that's why there's a lot of upsets. There's guys like Jake Shields who... Rick Story would come through on that division as well, on that side. Abu Bakr, for example. And, you know, people like Ray Cooper and another guy, Pavel Kush, who surprised Abu Bakr, which was surprising to me. And then when I match him against Ray Cooper, Ray Cooper walked in and destroyed him. And so it's just, yeah, no, the season's been, it's just been absolutely amazing.
Can I be a dick for a second?
Of course.
All right. One thing I thought about when Ray was talking about how much you've been in the gym, I follow you guys like on Instagram and all that, and I did notice that on days where I just wouldn't assume you would be there, you would be there. Not only that, for like the early classes that you guys would have like on the weekends and stuff like that, he would be there. And I thought about, what is it, because people are going to ask, like, you've turned it up a notch, but like, why now? In other words, people will ask, back a few years ago, why not then? Is it strictly just the money, or was it like pride? What did it come down to?
The money is a big motivator, but at the same time, like, you know, it gets to a point when it starts to get like I'll give a couple of examples. So I lost to David Branch. I you know, later on I start to think that I was not well prepared to take that fight, like such a big fight, the way I did. Like I took that fight, it was after my hand injury, so I broke my hand against Jake Hyun. And when he got offered for the David Branch fight, it was like 8 weeks. So it's like, you know, it's a full camp. Mm-hmm. But now you're talking about a guy who's coming off an injury, a serious injury that kept him out for 3 months. Like, you know, my hand, like 3 months later, was still like not fully functional. And then, again, I took the fight and think, well, you know, in 8 weeks I can get in shape. But think about it. Now you're injured, so it's not just about getting in shape. Like, you know, you got to get in shape. You got to get your technique going. You got to start to feel comfortable, like, you know, sparring and all that. At the end of it, you can look like even like, My physique was not the same. Like, look at that fight, the way I'm looking now, the way I was looking at that fight, it was kind of like fat. Like, I went up a size to fight that fight. You know, now I have 32, 34 for my fight shorts. On that fight, I had to go 36 because I was not, like, in my best shape. And then again, so I took a title fight, lost. Fine, at least I lost to a guy who's, like, you know, a two-time champion, great fighter. So it's one of those things, well, it doesn't look as bad. Then I go to Poland and I lose to a guy who's, like, a nobody. That's a fact. I lost to the guy, but I'm just being honest. He's a nobody. You should never beat me. You know, at my best, that guy should not get a win against me. And I go there and lose a decision. Then I start to question myself. Look, man, like, you know, you didn't win ATC by being lucky. you didn't win like world titles by being lucky. You know, you have not won like these some of these fighting against guys are really tough, like much better than these guys I have lost to by being lucky. So like, why not, you know, be yourself and like take things seriously? Because like, you know, I do have that talent, so might as well just take advantage of that talent. Like people say, well, you know, if it doesn't matter if you have talent, but if you don't work hard. So that's pretty much what I was. You know, I felt like, well, I do have the talent, but if I don't work hard, people are gonna outwork me, and that's what was happening like in these fights. And not just that, but then I also start to look at like in jiu-jitsu competition, which is more like something that, you know, I came from that. And then I look at the guys that I have won. Like, you know, I'll give an example. I don't know if you guys would know Cyborg. He's a, you know, multi, like, HC champion, world champion.
His first name Roberto?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So I had, like, 2 submission wins over that guy. And those are 2 submission wins, not even trying too hard. And then the last match that I had against him, the guy just embarrassed me. Like, you know, there was no, like, a lot of points. He just scored, like, 3 points for taking my back. And that was it. But I couldn't move, and then he was dominating the whole time. Even though I was being able to avoid things from happening, I was just not being able to move. So I was like, come on, man. Like, you know, you're better than this. So you just got to, you know, be yourself. And then, you know, put those 2 things together. Well, you know, a lot of things actually together. You're getting older. You know, you start to make yourself look bad. And there's a lot of money involved. So why not, you know, mm-hmm. take things seriously? And that's why, like, you know, I decided this year to take things seriously. I just remember the one time that I trained as serious as I've been training for this year was when I won the world title as a brown belt, which I had the best performance of all brown belts, like, from the last 10 years, 15 years. And I had, like, 13 matches. I won 10 by submissions, like, at Worlds. And then,
is that when you were doing the flying arm bars?
No, that was even before that. Oh. That was even before that. But that for that tournament, I trained, like, twice a day jiu-jitsu. So I was just doing jiu-jitsu. All I had to do was jiu-jitsu. I didn't have to box. I didn't have to do anything else. So I was doing twice a day jiu-jitsu and conditioning. So I was training, like, 3 times a day for a jiu-jitsu tournament. So I was at a professional level in an amateur sport. So that's why I was able to dominate. So I was like, dude, if I do the same in MMA, I can dominate too. And that's why, like, you know, I just, you know, I changed my mindset. And I feel like, that's why I truly believe that, you know, this tournament is for me to win. You know, as much as I respect Sean, there's no way that he can outwork me. There's no way. As much people say he's tough, he's durable and all that, he's not working harder than I am. He doesn't have more talent than I have. So it's going to be tough for him to beat me. It's going to come down to one of those things. And if he gets lucky, yeah. But, like, as far as the skills, as far as hard work, there's no way that he's going to beat me.
Have you noticed that throughout the PFL season, we've heard some pretty unique stories? Like, that's pretty unique what he's saying. Mm-hmm. What Will Brooks did to kind of turn his life around, his mindset. And then even, like, Steven Seiler, what he talked about.
He moved.
Was, yeah, moving, his wife working 2 jobs. But because that money's out there and that possibility, he was right. able to change things in his life because now there's more to fight for. Like, that's what's been pretty cool about all this.
And that's stories. The thing. Yeah, and that's the thing that a lot of people forget is that sometimes it takes certain things for people to click. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Some could be, for example, $1 million. Some could be because of a fight that he watched. And you know what? I know I can do that. You know what I mean? Again, I go back to, you know, how amazing Vinny's looked for the season. How amazing Ray Cooper's looked for. Because when I signed Ray Cooper, no one really knew who Ray Cooper was or is, right? And that guy has been a beast as well.
Stud.
Yeah. You know, when he fought against Ferreira, who's another stud, and that was the last guy that Ray lost to coming into before the PFL started. And so when that happened, Ronnie and I had a bet that I bet him that Ray Cooper is going to beat him and when they meet again in the season. Reason why? Because I think Ray Cooper took that fight on short notice. Because, you know, when you don't have anything or not signed to anybody, you don't really know when the next paycheck is going to come or when the next fight would happen. In this scenario, he's in the season. And so he's in training camp right throughout the year. And in terms of being prepared and ready, he was going to be ready. And look what happened. He stopped him in the first round. And yet he lost to him on a decision in their first fight.
Folks, let me go through this with you. We got the fight order for December 31st, PFL 11, the championship. The middleweights, Abus Magomedov versus Lewis Taylor. Taylor will be joining us here in about 15 minutes on the show. They kick off the night. Where does Kayla Harrison fit in, by the way?
Should be probably in the middle.
In the middle, okay. Yeah. Then the next fight will be Steven Seiler versus Lance Palmer. Remember, NBC Sports, 7 p.m. Eastern start time. Then we got Nathan Schulte versus Rashid Magomedov. I saw Schulte fight in Long Beach. Actually, I saw Magomedov fight as well. That's going to be a really, really good fight.
Yep.
Then the featured bout is Vinny Magalhães versus Sean O'Connell. The co-main event, Felipe Lenz versus Josh Copeland. And the main event, Ray Cooper III versus Magomedkerimov. Six title fights, and they're all slated for five-minute rounds, and that's why it's going to be a four-hour broadcast, including Kayla Harrison, who will try and go 3-0 in her career. I don't think we're going to get six decisions.
No.
I mean, he hasn't gotten out of the first, and I think Cooper's been making quick work as well. The heavyweights always pack that type of punch where it can end. Lance Palmer seems pretty programmed where he wants to end it quickly. The lightweights, perhaps, maybe. I can see the featherweights still going a couple rounds. Siler's a tough dude, man. You can't just get rid of him either.
No.
So it's going to be a fun night that leads into New Year's Eve. Great timing.
It's going to be a new
theater inside the Madison Square Garden on December 31st. Huh? Yeah.
I said it's going to be an emotional night. And I bet you Ray will cry at some point that night.
Yeah.
There's a lot of emotions
doubt
on the line here.
Yeah. No, without a doubt, especially because
he cried.
Sitting there and seeing it all, unfold and champion after champion after champion. I'm sure that's going to be an emotional moment for myself as well. I mean, of course, the fighters, but I think everybody in our team are going to be quite emotional throughout the night.
I'm going to take a Xanax before this dude because there's so many ups and downs that night. It's going to be crazy.
Right.
Yeah. 7 to 11 p.m. Eastern Start Time, and there are tickets available. We were just in Madison Square Garden. We saw all the videos on all the billboards, and they are promoting it heavily. Can't wait. 50. Wait, sorry, 10 million on the line. Remember, the runner-ups also get 200 grand, and they've been paying very well along the way. And you just told us season 2 starts in May.
First week of May, correct.
All right. Any other fun facts you can share just yet?
There's a lot of fun facts coming.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I can't share it right now, but there's some beautiful things happening in the works that should be announced in the early year.
How does NBC Sports Network, have they been treating you guys? Are they as excited as you guys are?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, they are. Yeah.
I heard that a lot of companies are trying to get in the MMA space. So I think MMA's had a good presence,
right,
whether it be digital or on television, like the last 2-3 years.
Right.
CBS Sports Network, they've taken on some MMA. Everybody's taken on some MMA.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. Good time to be a promoter or a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
And these paydays are something else. All right, Vinny. Submission, KO, what do you look at? Didn't you win your title in M1 with a striking, right?
I did. Yeah. It's funny.
We watched that like at 6 a.m., didn't we?
Yeah, we had to end the show early.
Yeah, I remember that.
We had a technical
difficulty. Yeah, so the M1 title I won by a submission. I defended with the head kick.
Oh, that's
right. And then there was Titan, which I initiated the finish with the head kick and finished with a submission.
Yeah.
So I don't know how it's going to go now. It could go either way. Because I've already done both. A knockdown to a submission. I've done a knockout, and I've done a submission title fight. So this one, I would say submission.
You ever trained with Sean before?
Just make it obvious, submission. I never trained with him. I've met him 10 years ago, on the Ultimate Fighter. He was trying out for it. He didn't make it to the house. But, then after, I didn't see him for years until, you just saw, each other, this year, in Orlando for PFL, and that was it. But we don't even know each other that well. We're not friends. We don't talk too much.
Do you guys have to fill the 4 hours?
What do you mean?
If the first three end early, do the announcers have to fill in? Is there a certain schedule? You'll have to fill in the 4 hour block?
Probably.
Yeah. Wow, that can be pretty tricky. But it's a good thing to have, right?
It's a good thing to have. Yeah.
Damn, man. All right.
Yeah.
I know you're looking forward to all the fights. But tell me what you're looking forward to in 2019. Is there any goals you've set for the promotion or new cities to take the show to?
Yes, there is some developments there. But What am I looking forward to? Well, I guess, I mean, I'm just looking forward to season 2019 as a whole, if you will, right? This year has been a successful year for PFL. And so looking at 2019, I want the same kind of success, especially the way the fighters have come out and fought. And I think everybody have lived up to the hype, if you will. And I wish for the same thing to happen in 2019. Everybody come out, and the goal is to finish. The goal is to come out and put the best fight on that they could put on.
Will all the winners be a part of 2019?
100%, yes.
I think what would be cool is the first episode to have the winners kind of come out. I mean, you know how they do in pro sports where they get a ring? I'm not saying they have to get them a ring or another millions. Plenty.
That's a good idea.
But I something like with like – you know how Bellator hangs the banners of the champions? Maybe that, or just some sort of a commemorative. You know what I mean? Because this is season one. That's pretty historic.
Right.
Something on their trunks, and too, right?
Yeah, just something that recall. Like, it's even if it's just a video package or something like that, I'm trying to throw ideas your way. Remember Ghost had the $1 million
right
idea?
Yep.
We're crazy fans over here, man.
No, all that's been, you know, has been in talks and – and so something is going
to
happen.
Ghost wanted to wear a black suit with black glasses and a briefcase with a handcuff.
Right. Men in Black?
Yeah, something like that. he wanted to walk into the octagon, and then you guys would open the key, and he'd open the briefcase, and you'd take out the check and give it to each winner.
See, look. Yeah. Yeah, you never know.
And
right?
He would be escorted by
right
two others.
Right.
You know, I don't know. Crazy stuff.
Unless I just pay us in cash, too. That would be nice.
This isn't pride. All right. Well, we got Lewis Taylor coming up, but I want to thank you guys very much for stopping by.
Thank you.
We look forward to PFL 11 on December 31st. Congrats, man. You really, really turned it around.
Right.
Don't kick my ass, but I felt like at times you just kind of had – lazy's too strong of a word.
It might not be.
You know what I mean? Like, it just seemed like you had another gear you could hit, and you finally hit it. You know what I mean? I commend you for that. You did it at the right time.
I agree with you, though.
And then when Goz asked the question, I also felt like I think your kids also were another motivator.
That's for sure, 100%.
So, because you're fucking there all the time. When I go to Extreme Couture, there's always Vinny. There's always Ray, but there's always Vinny. That's for sure. So he's not lying about that. I've seen you work out. I've seen the dedication. Your walk-around weight's now, what, like low 220s?
221.
Remember when it used to be high 240s?
221 now,
you see
what
I'm saying? So, like, that's a whole new – it's a different Vinny. And you did it at the right time. So, like, I really, really commend you for that, my man.
I felt bad. Yeah, so he didn't offend me at all. Like, I agree with you.
But
though,
I just felt like the most honest way was at least say it that way rather than sugarcoat it, you know? And if I have to take a leg kick or get Komored after the show, then I'll take it. But I don't know. Just figured I've always – figured that the most direct thing with these guys is just to tell them exactly how you feel. And
I felt bad asking the question, but I didn't feel as bad when his fat pants were size 36. I used to wear 36. I said,
no. I know. Now he's walking around 34s.
Right. I even like to fit in 32s, man. Last time I fit in 32s, I was like 23 years old.
Wow.
11 years ago. So.
All right, guys. Thanks very much for stopping by.
You know, I just started Gi, too. So,
oh, yeah?
Gi Jiu-Jitsu, yeah. And
nice.
With the master himself. Of course.
Okay.
You got to start from the bottom.
Crazy, man.
Yeah. It's like the toughest white belt in the world.
Exactly. Well, all the fun he gets to have with the striking, right, when he's out there striking with you guys.
Yeah.
He's sitting there like winking, letting me know, watch this, and he throws some crazy combos
like
at you guys.
Looking at you.
And now you guys get to have a little bit of it back. All right, that's Vinny Magalhaes at Vinny MMA, and this is Ray Seffo at Sugar Ray Seffo. Follow them on Twitter and keep an eye out for PFL 11 on December 31st. We will, of course, be watching it live from the Hulu Theater, 7 p.m. Eastern Start Time on NBC Sports Network. It's channel 220 if you have DirecTV like Goz and I. Otherwise, check your local satellite and cable listings. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll talk to Lewis Taylor. It's MMA Junkie Radio on Fight Nation, channel 93.
sack, but act as though they've never met. They are the brothers Garcia, Gorgeous George, and Goes.
One moment you're talking about ball sacks, the next minute I got to remind you all that in the spirit of the holidays, with SiriusXM's full lineup of holiday channels, 15 channels, by the way, of commercial-free holiday music, including holiday traditions on Channel 3, contemporary sounds of the season, they're on Halle, Channel 4. And new this year, the stars of the Hallmark Channel, they present their holiday favorites on Hallmark Channel Radio, that's Channel 70. Get our complete holiday lineup at SiriusXM.com/holidays. Bring the holiday cheer into your home on SiriusXM connected devices and speakers. All right, we're going to continue the PFL takeover, except our guests that are in studio, they've gone. Big thanks to Greg Savage for helping us line up Lance Palmer, Vinny Magalhaes, and president of PFL, Ray Cepho. Now we have another finalist from the PFL 11 card, the championship, joining us here on the hotline via the phone, Lewis Taylor. He'll be fighting Abusipian Magomedov. They are middleweights. And again, the winner gets $1 million PFL. Comes your way on December 31st from the Hulu Theater inside Madison Square Garden. And it's a 7 p.m. Eastern start time for all of you on NBC Sports. Check it out. What's up, Lewis Taylor? How you doing?
I'm all good, all good. Ready to get this New Year's rolling with my new money.
Well, I'm glad we were able to connect. We had a few problems a few weeks ago, but I figured, you know what? We had plenty of time, and I wanted you to stay on the course with your training or whatever it was that was keeping you busy, because this is the most important training camp of your life.
Yes, sir. Just watching a little bit of your clip. That's an awesome setup you guys got going over there.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, the guys just left. Cepho was here with Vinny Magalhaes and Lance Palmer. Man, those guys are ready. I imagine you're feeling the same way. I bet you could probably fight tonight if they asked you to.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I can make weight, too. I'm good to go.
Mm-hmm. All right, so tell me, this season, you know, you won all your fights, and I want to know, what do you carry from that? What kind of momentum are you carrying into these finals? Did you learn?
With MMA, it's a little different than, boxing. You know, each fight, it's his own fight, and each fight is the biggest fight of your life. I was glad to actually be able to get two fights in at one night. I wasn't feeling the greatest about my fight with Rex. And then I had, I was able to get right back in there against John Howard, so I felt good about that quick turnaround, so I didn't have to go home, wait months to fight again, and then get that taste out my mouth. And now I'm ready to put on an even better show against Abusipian Magomedov New Year's Eve.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember the Howard fight. It was a lot of confusion there. But did you know before they were able to sort it out exactly what was going on? I mean, it seemed like a lot of people were communicating around the cage. Do you remember how all that went down?
I mean, I was lost in the sauce, man. I was lost. Pissed, upset, ready to go, happy. Every emotion you can go through in 14 minutes, I went through it right there. After a few minutes, I'm like, okay, why am I still in this cage? If they're, I'm just waiting on them to tell me that I'm DQ'd or whatever. And I'm knowing that Howard could have still continued to fight. But I'm like, well, it is what it is. Let me the hell up out of here so I can go, go through my own emotions in my locker room.
Right.
I was trying to get the hell out of the cage, and Rex and Ray and Carlos was like, go sit your ass down, and we're going to handle this thing, And I was like, all right, so I went, and I'm waiting. I'm getting into it with my own cornermen and everything. I'm just like, I'm ready to get the hell out the cage because I'm already knowing I saw this story play out before, And I'm thinking that they're going to try to DQ me. When I know I barely touched John. That type of contact happens all the time, but he didn't want to continue, and I figured that it was going to play out in his favor. But I'm blessed, and I'm glad that everybody who prayed, their prayers worked, and I got a chance to move on.
Yep. Lewis Taylor joining us here on the hotline. He'll be facing Abusipian Magomedov on December 31st at PFL 11. These are middleweights, and like I stated, all show long, and I will continue all the way through December 31st. The winner gets $1 million. That's life-changing. Goes, what do you have for Lewis Taylor?
You know, that I wanted to talk about that exact moment, Lewis, because watching that on TV, man, I had I got socked in the stomach watching you go through all that, because there were so many different scenarios that were playing out. And for me, it's just kind of like a fight fan, somebody that covers the sport. But for you, $1 million was on the line. I want to talk about one specific moment, and it's one that you brought up, was when you were exiting the cage and Carlos and Ray stopped you. Did you know at that moment what was on the line with that, as far as it, had you made it to the back, and what that could have actually ended the whole scenario right there?
Oh, yeah.
Did
yeah.
you know that at the time?
No, I didn't. That would have messed me up. But you know, they're the bosses. So once they, you know, told me go, you know, get back in the cage and calm down, you know, I just listened, and went. And I didn't know what was gonna happen. You know, you don't want to sit there and wait all that time just so the other man can celebrate in your face. Honestly, you know what I'm saying. And it's just like I wanted to, you know, I wanted to get up out of there. You know, we're fighters and we control. We learn to control our anger, but there's only so much that we can control it. And that was definitely pushing the limits for me.
When we were talking about all the people that are involved in these fights, I thought about one advantage that I feel like you may have over everybody competing. And it's the fact that you went through that scenario, because you're one of the only guys that knows what that feels like to have it taken away from you. And you experienced that, you know, that you could very well have not been in that moment. And I think it's almost like this type of shock that goes through your system, that I feel like if there's anyone they're going to have to pry $1 million from, it's you, even more than everyone else. Is that accurate at all?
I think it is accurate. That's a great point. A lot of people, they talk about the stress after you've already almost had it taken away. You really don't have the same amount of stress. You know, you're just going in there to have fun and to perform and to be the best you. I'm not sitting around, you know, $1 million. I'm just ready to go in there and fight. At the end of the day, me and the boys are gonna fight, I'm gonna win, and everything that's mine is gonna be mine.
All right, Lewis Taylor joining us here on the hotline. Dan Tom, our fight analyst, what do you have for Lewis Taylor?
Hey Lewis, I'm looking at your Instagram right now, and I got one question for you. Who's the master?
Lou Taylor out of Chicago, Illinois.
All right, that is one of two acceptable answers. Of course, the other one, for those wondering what we're talking about, is Shownuff. Of course, we're citing The Last Dragon, a cult classic. Are you about The Last Dragon, Lewis?
About The Last Dragon. You know, when I was a kid, that movie was everything. It was, you know, iconic movie for us kids growing up in the city.
Mm-hmm.
I was also a martial arts fan. My father was a big martial artist. So that was one of those ones where even my mom liked, you know. That was my mom's favorite movie. So that was something we always had in common. I think I bought her, like, a great, like, box set collection for Christmas one year just because she likes the movie that much.
I love that. That was the answer I was hoping to hear. Not to put you too much on the spot, but since you're a martial arts fan, like you said, if you had a top five, Lewis, what can you just give us a couple? What would be the top five just for martial arts movies? Let us know what you dig.
Let's see. I got to throw The Last Dragon in there because it's up on topic. And I'm going to say No Retreat, No Surrender. I'm going to say nice. Bloodsport, Into the Dragon.
All right.
Ninja Scroll, which is an anime, which is so fun. It was at four.
Yeah, I think it was four.
Yeah, and you know, pretty much, I'm a Bruce Lee, a Jean-Claude Van Damme fan.
So, nice.
You know, although Steven Seagal did his thing, so any of those movies I probably watched 1,000 times.
Lionheart, man, Lionheart, and
Lion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Lionheart's kind of like MMA too, especially what you're doing with the season and all going to the end. You got the final boss now, Usyk Magomedov. Just real quick, last thing for me. What's your breakdown on this gentleman? I know a lot of people were high on him, but as we've seen with a lot of finals, which I love seeing these underdogs come through, and you can't sleep on anybody. But what's your breakdown on him?
No, you know, everybody's high on him, but they've been high on, you know, I've been an underdog this entire tournament. You know, it wasn't until recently people actually started thinking, like, maybe this kid can win it, you know. But, you know, for me it's nothing new. But this kid is legit, and I like fighting people who bring out the best in me, you know. So Because a lot of times when I beat people, people always say, oh, that guy must have not been that good, you know? Mm-hmm. So I want after I beat a boost, I want them to say the same things, that every time I beat somebody, he must have not been good, you know? You know, so but that's the thing. He's definitely an up and coming fighter, but I'm gonna go show the world what I do, and people still haven't figured me out yet, and that's the problem.
How big will the Lewis Taylor contingent be in New York City on December 31st? A lot of people riding with you?
Oh yeah, it's gonna be a lot of flights, a lot of drive, a lot of Airbnb staying. It's gonna be nice. It's gonna be a nice mix of diversity of every color, creed, religion in a book is showing up for this fight.
Man, that's awesome. Lewis, how many times were you told this season, or well, how many times have you been told, I didn't think you were gonna be in the finals?
Right off the bat, I mean, it's been a long time coming, but I think after my second fight is when a lot of people started actually changing their tune. You know, from the higher up in the PFL to the common fan. But after I won the second fight, and they saw the first fight I won it by, strike. Second fight I won by just using wrestling and dominant control. And people realized that I'm actually a tougher fight than they thought.
Right. All right. Well, hey, I'm glad we were able to connect. And, you know, good luck with the rest of your camp. Safe holidays, safe travels to New York. And go out there and do your thing, man. Have some fun on December 31st. This is history here, you know, with an organization paying out $1 million to six different athletes, $200,000 to the runners-up on NBC Sports. You know, this format, really, they pulled it off. It was amazing. I had my doubts because this is something we had heard about in our circles for, like, the last 5 or 6 years. I'd never doubted PFL or WSOF because WSOF had a nice little, you know, nice run there before they became PFL. But the idea about the $1 million that I had heard 5, 6 years ago, I just thought it kind of went away. And here we are, man, a couple weeks away, and it's going to be pretty historic.
It is, and I'm glad to be a part of this inaugural season. I appreciate you guys having me on, and I look forward to getting back on when I can tell you I'm the PFL world champ.
That's what's up.
We can't wait to ask you to borrow money.
All right, Lewis. Thanks for the time.
Appreciate it.
All right. We'll see you later. All right, folks. We have one more commercial. Fight Nation, Channel 93. Stay close. We'll be right back.
They taught Andy Griffith how to whistle. Here are Gorgeous George and Goes.
Get the radio channel numbers and a link to listen to your favorite NFL, college, basketball, NBA, or NHL team sent right to your smart device. Just go to SiriusXM.com/sports today and click Add to My Calendar. All right, guys, we had a lot of fun with the PFL. We did a nice takeover there, and again, thanks to all the guys that came through and Lewis Taylor for calling in. Now let's finish up with a daily debate, and we'll get the hell out of Dodge. You guys ready?
Mm-hmm. Let's do it.
All right, so the question is, now pay attention to how it's worded, because this was a little tricky for some of the commenters I noticed. Do you agree with John Jones's decision to decline additional drug testing through VADA before UFC 232? Now remember, all the athletes go through USADA testing, random testing throughout the year. VADA would be in addition to, and it was recommended by the CSAC prior to him getting his license. It wasn't mandatory, it was licensed, or it was recommended. But with everything that's, you know, tainted, or in air quotes, tainted his legacy, I think that's why the question is being brought forward. And I'll repeat it again. Do you agree with John Jones' decision to decline additional drug testing through VADA before UFC 232? Dan, Tom?
If it's just a basic yes or no, I'll say no, just because for me that's easy money. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't like people being PR just to do it and be fake. In fact, that was one of John Jones's early criticism. And I will say since then, I've always respected him as a fighter. That's been never in question. But I actually dare say I like this unapologetic John Jones a little more. But as far as this decision, guys, I think it was just an easy decision here to gain somewhat of good faith and show you're trying, you know, like earn a community service point, slap that sign on your way out the door. Just didn't feel like it was that much extra compared to what USADA is already asking of these athletes, which is a lot. So I guess I'll say no.
Okay, how about you guys?
I disagree with John Jones for a lot of points that Dan made. If my problem is showing up to work late every day, to change that, I don't show up on time, I show up early. You do things to help that out. We talk about legacy a lot with this guy, right? So why wouldn't you cross every T and dot every I that you could, especially a guy like John Jones that has money, has time. I would go the extra step to do that, to show everybody that I am that person. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying he's wrong by not doing it, but I would, if it were me, I would do that.
Mm-hmm. All right, now I actually read into this yesterday, and remember how I had speculated that maybe it had to do with recreational drugs or whatever. And okay. He's been open about it. I still drink it, still smoke pot, and maybe VADA's had laxer rules. And it didn't. They were only going to test them for performance enhancing, you know, that type of drug. And so when I read that, I was like, well, John, I think you should have done this. I don't agree with his decision to decline. I thought he should have. It would have been, I believe, fairly easy. I just don't know. Maybe the athlete's concerned of, well, how many times am I giving blood on fight week? You know, I know some have had that. Remember Manny Pacquiao used to have that concern?
Yeah.
Some people just don't like it, but others feel like it drains them. And it being a big fight, maybe just the least amount of times to do it, the better. But if they're pitching it, it must not feel like it is something that's going to impact them physically. So why not do it and just... He's been so vocal about wanting to eradicate any thoughts of him ever being a cheater. Do this.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess we're on the same side.
Yeah. It's tough, though, when you look at his career, though. Now, because of that, I think people are going to feel like USADA's not good enough. And you can't really do that because you can only do what's available, right? For every other fighter, it's been okay. It's been the standard, right? When guys test okay, we don't go, yeah, but what if they would have done VADA? But he's not doing himself any favors.
His attorney apparently said that when they asked for more clarification on what that would, what that would entail, the California State Athletic Commission wasn't able to offer it, and so that's why they backed off. Which I like that there was at least some support, you know, from the legal side of things or whatever to clear up confusion. But one thing that's different about VADA that I read about is, when they collect, it's turned over, I guess, to the commissions, whereas USADA does, I guess, all of their own, all the internal work, you know, amongst themselves. So I don't know if that meant that's just an extra handoff or who knows. All we have is a yes or a no, and I think we're all kind of on the same sides here. But Junkie Nation thought otherwise. They were a little bit more split down the middle. 812 people voted. 54% agreed with us, no. 46% said yes.
Huh.
So
all right, it's pretty close there.
Yeah. I feel like I may give him a little bit more wiggle room if he was a little bit more vocal in why. But they wasn't, other than Howard Jacobs, you know, saying, hey, we just didn't get enough info that we wanted. You know, a lot of media and most fans will just gloss over the did he do it or not, and he didn't. Oh, well, there goes the speculation again. Mm-hmm. And that'll hurt John Jones. And I think he cares about his legacy. He may say he doesn't, but I think he does. Folks, we got to get on out of here. There you have it. There's today's Daily Debate brought to you by the MMA Junkie Radio team. And thank you all for tuning in to the show today. Thanks to Lewis Taylor for his time, Ray Cepho, Benny Magalhaes, and Lance Palmer. Tomorrow we will be joined by Tony Martin, C.R. Bahardizada, and Justin Willis. Maybe a couple other names. Don't want to jinx them now, so I won't announce them. We got to get out of here, though, folks. Go out there and be a champion.